Hello again, welcome back to Microsoft Mechanics Live. Today we're going to take a look at a 15-minute tour of all the latest compliance and security updates to Microsoft 365, really starting with defense-in-depth capabilities across identity, data, devices, and applications, including the latest in passwordless authentication and also information protection and advanced threat protection, plus improvements to assessing and managing your security and compliance posture across Microsoft 365 with one of my favorite capabilities, Microsoft Secure Score, the new Compliance Manager, Advanced eDiscovery, and much more. Today I'm joined by Adam Hall from the Microsoft 365 Security Compliance Team. Welcome.
Thank you, sir. Good for having
me. Give a big warm welcome to Adam. All right. So security and compliance, really two areas that are starting to fuse together in a lot of interesting ways. These worlds are converging. Can you tell us more about this?
Absolutely. So while we have two dedicated teams working on security and compliance, there is a frequent intersection, particularly when it results in information about people, the right of the user, and so on. We've seen regulatory compliance, things like GDPR, coming along where this is not just compliance for knowing what's going on. This is about the rights of the individual, and companies need to be able to know, in the event of a breach, was my information leaked or not? And I can come to you and say, tell me, and be able to prove, did you have a leak for me or not? And so as an example, in GDPR, there's all these statutes which basically say, prove to me that you had controls in place, and prove to me that you know whether my information was affected or not.
And so you can see with that example that really these are things that you have to be able to prove and make sure that you've got evidence of all of that. Otherwise, there are hefty fines that you might have to face in those cases. So why don't we start with security? I think everybody here was very interested in the topic of security. Yep. What approach are we taking there with Microsoft 365?
So we have to be constantly hardening our own platforms. And we think about this across identity, information protection, threat protection, and security management. The foundation we use for all of these is how we run our cloud platforms ourselves. We have dedicated security teams. We have teams like Research Center, Threat Intelligence, we call Mystic. And there's like three or four thousand people whose jobs it is to do security research, identify exploits and vulnerabilities, and feed into our intelligence so that you can leverage those learnings as customers as well. Our identity services team, they're stopping tens of millions of attacks every single day. And so we're really on the forefront there of trying to do identity protection as well. We take all this information and then we apply machine learning at massive scale to be able to constantly improve and evolve on our detections every single day.
So some of the things that we're seeing in terms of what we're looking at is all the different signals that we've got with data encryption, malware, all of the multi-factor authentication, logins that we're seeing. All these are signals that we're processing every day, right?
Yes, and the security graph is collecting these vast amounts of information, trillions of signals per day. These are coming from different services. There's a couple of hundred commercial and consumer services, as well as third-party sources. And all of this information comes in so that we can run these machine learning algorithms and heuristics to say, what have we got? And that feeds the insights into our Microsoft 365 services.
Right, and I know there's been a number of new recent innovations, but can we take a look at some of the new things?
Excellent. So let's start with identity, the front door. For a long time, passwords have been the way for people to be able to authenticate. I guess that most people are using a password as their primary authentication. But the sophistication of the attacks means that that's just simply not good enough. They're too weak, and it's not a good foundation. And as we see more and more attacks becoming more and more prolific, we've been on a mission to eliminate the password. And so we've been working on eliminating that, bringing in multi-factor authentication. We started with Windows Hello on Windows 10, where we introduced the ability to use facial recognition or things like fingerprints to be able to authenticate without a password into your account. And then we have the Authenticator app, which is now updated to support passwordless authentication as well. So using that same underlying technology as Windows Hello to power authentication in a cloud context.
All right, well, let's see what that looks like on
Absolutely.
Your Mac.
So let's start with this on the Mac. I am trying to log into office.com here, and I'm going to try and log in. Now, as I select my account, instead of being asked for a password, what I'm going to see, if I can click that, there it goes. It helps if I click. I'm going to see that I'm prompted with a code, and I'm getting the same code on my phone. I need to select that to identify that I have the device that's in front of it, and then I'm asked to authenticate using my thumbprint on the phone as well. Straight after that, I'm straight through to Office. I can now launch my applications. And now I can log into all of these cloud applications without any further authentication. And I don't have to remember passwords anymore. And that's a great thing.
Very cool. And of course, to take this one step further, you can use things like conditional access controls. In fact, we have a dedicated show on this topic, but beyond the controls in terms of real-time assessments, we're also being, they're being accessed. What additional things can we do to protect the information itself as it's being shared, or as, or maybe if bad actors somehow have infiltrated into my network or got potential access to it, what do we do there?
So information protection is probably the area with the biggest overlap between security and compliance. Mm-hmm. And we have had a number of updates in this space. We've been on a mission to unify classification and labeling for both sensitivity labels and retention labels. So labels that apply to email and documents, and email that apply to compliance, retention, archival, and so on. So this is the Security and Compliance Center, and we've brought together all of the security and all of the compliance into one console. On the right, left-hand side here, we have classifications. And if I just zoom in here, we will see that we have two options, the sensitivity labels on the left-hand side and the retention labels on the right. This allows us to compile in one place the taxonomies for both sensitivity and classification and retention. Within each of those, we can bring up a configuration of each one. This highly confidential label allows me to turn on things like encryption. Do I want visual marking like watermarks, headers, and footers, and any other settings around automated labeling, content detection, and so on.
Very good. So Office for Mac is something also that we've got now with additional protections around. What can we do there?
So we've seen the admin side. On the client side, we need a great user experience. And we've had this in Office on Windows for a while now. And now we have native configuration within Office.
And I have
Mac
to add,
well.
There's no more add-in. It's also native in the ribbon.
No more add-ins. This is native into the ribbon. I have a sensitivity label here and a document that's open. It's currently classified as general. This has pulled down the taxonomy that we just looked at in the admin console, currently labeled as general. I'm going to move this to highly confidential. And what you'll see is a couple of things happen. In the background, the watermark is now kicked in to say it's highly confidential. And down the bottom here, we've identified to the user that we've moved from a general classification to highly confidential. This is metadata on the document. It can travel anywhere. And we'll always know what the classification of that document is as a native experience on the Mac.
And it's really a great way to, it's really great actually to see all this update to classifying and protecting your data. But that said, even the best thought out security mechanisms, the best thought out processes, data classifications that you make, really the best defense is kind of assuming that somebody's inside already, that you're not complacent, that you know that breaches are going to happen. We call that assume breach. Yep. What are we doing there in terms of if bad actors actually do find a way?
So it's absolutely a best practice to assume breach. And for every organization across users, the devices, the data, cloud applications, infrastructure, assume that the bad actors are already in. And so as a good example with NotPetya, we were monitoring email and browser-based attacks, but this was very different. This was a completely new attack vector where NotPetya got into the packaging process of a valid application update. That put the payload into the package, and it was deployed out. A valid process with a valid package, but now with a nefarious ransomware attack inside of it. So that just proves that the modern workplace, very complex, that you need to have a set of services that are secure, but everything in your environment is a potential attack vector.
Right, so what additional ways then do we have to protect and detect and respond to new forms of attacks?
So within our Microsoft 365 services, we think a lot about intelligence, integration, and automation. And we take all the learnings of that and build it and bake it into the services that we ship. So we have lots of new and updated technologies, along with things like user education. So Attack Simulator, for example, allows you to do a targeted attack in a safe way on your own users to identify who are the risky users, who are the ones that are going to click on this wrong link and do the wrong thing, helping you educate your users to do the right thing so that you can help attacks from not happening as well.
All right, so what does that experience look like? Because I know that we're bringing back some of the threat experiences together into one console, right?
So we're bringing all of that signal together. We talked about multiple trillions of signals, but what does that mean to our customers? We want to bring it together into a new security center where we bring this in and show you what the threat correlations mean to you. So this is the new security center, and there's lots of rich information here that is relevant to your environment. I can drill in and take a look at the incidents. Here I have a number of incidents that are going on. I'm going to drill into one of them. Now, an incident is not an isolated thing. It's not one event, it's not one log, it's lots of things going on. And so within this incident, there are a number of alerts that have popped up, and I can click into one of them and drill in. In this case, we have a suspicious PowerShell script that's been run across a number of entities. I can take different pivots. So we have the devices that have been affected by this incident. I can see potential attack vectors like email and data that the payload came through. I can see the users that have been affected. And then we roll that all together into what we call an investigation playbook. And this playbook gives you a step-by-step view into all of the things that have happened, all the remediations that we've run, and give you a view of that. And so you can graphically see all the things that happened, all the things that have done. And in this case, we've done an automatic remediation because this is just things that we should clean up straight away without you having to spend time thinking about it.
This is very cool. So can these insights then feed into other security solutions, maybe SIEM solutions that you might be running?
So absolutely. And we've just made available the Microsoft Grab API. Which allows us to bring all of those workloads, make them available to you, and integrate with third parties as well through the Graph Explorer API. This provides a connection interface to all of those alerts and all those security services within your environment and our partners as well.
And some of the partners that we have here are on the Microsoft Intelligent Security Association. Lots of big vendors, as you can see here, that are really providing some of the best solutions around protecting the cloud and your assets.
It's delivering the best result that we can for you as our joint customers, bringing all of that partnering extensive that we've got in the environment, bringing all those integrated alerts into a growing ecosystem of security intelligence partners.
Right, so once you have all the insights, how easy is it then to apply all the controls to your environment to mitigate against the different threats?
Our main solution here is Microsoft Secure Score. Now, this tool has been expanded from the original Office 365 and Windows to now include the Enterprise Mobility and Security Solutions as well. Today, I'm going to show you some of the new controls and take a look at what the future of this might look like. So this is the new Microsoft Security Center. And the first thing you'll notice is that we have a score 850 over 1,405. This is the score that I have over the potential that I have. Now, if any of you have looked at Secure Score previously, you'll be wondering, where did my dials go? Where did my office score go? Mm-hmm. We've moved to categories, which allows us to not only provide you with more information across a broader set of services, across identities, data, devices, apps, and infrastructure, but to also bring in extra signal that you might see from Azure Security Center so that we can bring that in, and that signal would come into the infrastructure section. We also give you all the guidance that we had before as well. So for example, I have this discover risky and non-compliant shadow IT applications in the environment. This is coming in from MCAS. I can take a look at that. It's going to tell me what it is, what it needs to do in order to be turned on. And giving you a very simple take action button, which would take me straight to the location to turn it on. Or if you're using a third party, you can also click that button because we recognize that you'll still want the score even though you don't use one of ours.
Very cool. So it's a really great place to get started if you're a security admin. And it's one of those awesome tools to really rate yourself against kind of the competition, give yourself a score. But if you're a compliance admin, what are some of the tools that you can use there to make sure that your organization's compliant?
And that's where Compliance Manager comes in. So pivoting a little bit into compliance, Compliance Manager is about helping you understand your compliance posture. And from a regulatory perspective, helping you understand what are the controls that are important to me, what are the things I need to be doing, and how can Microsoft help me understand what that is above and beyond all of the compliance that we build into our platform and services as well. So there are now 12 assessments available, including security control frameworks from such as NIST and FedRAMP. Now, by default, Compliance Manager doesn't turn them all on. We turn on the ones that we believe are most common, but you can always add more. So I can click on adding an assessment. There is a drop-down of options available. I'm going to select an Office 365 one, and then I'm going to enable NIST CSF. Once I add that to the dashboard, it will refresh and scroll down, and it will be added at the bottom. Now I can start to gain insights into what is my compliance score here and how am I going to help meet my compliance obligations. You'll see us keep expanding this. We're going to add more regulatory compliance regulations and industry standards over time.
So it's pretty significant progress in terms of even a few months ago, kind of when GDPR came into regulation, came actually to be a proper thing in May. So One area we haven't really covered yet, which is really important from a compliance perspective, though, is visibility and control over your data.
So some of the new capabilities we've got that are very exciting in the compliance realm are in eDiscovery. And so if we pop over into eDiscovery, we have some new features, such as long-term audit logs, file plan manager, and the ability to auto-apply labels to both Exchange and to SharePoint Online. These updates make it easier for you as our customers to be able to classify and govern sensitive data. So let's take a look. I'm going to click in. I've got a number of investigations going on here, and I will drill into one. Now, if I switch to the advanced eDiscovery, I start to see all of the information. The first glance that we've got here, though, is that we have nearly 181,000 results. That's way too many for me to be able to really understand what's going on. So we can do some advanced searching, bring in not only search queries, but we can also bring in conditions and themes as well. This allows us to do search and tagging and to say, for this information that comes in, I can now save this query, I can run it again, I can reduce that amount of data, and if I save and run that, I end up with a much smaller amount of only a few 90 results, and it's down from 181,000, simply by using the query results and bringing themes and search criteria in, and then being able to tag all that information so I can look it up from that point
forward. And it's using machine learning and some intelligence under the covers to do all of this, right?
Yep, all of that is powered by the search engine, the Microsoft search engine, and bringing in the power of the heuristics and the analytics as well.
So very cool. Awesome set of updates in terms of all the things that you can do from a compliance perspective. A lot of these are first looks. These are updates on the security and compliance fronts. Some of these things are rolling out now. Some are rolling out in a bit in the future. Thanks for joining us today, Adam. You've covered a lot of surface area really across all of the security and compliance spectrum. But where can people go to learn more?
So the best place to get all the information is to follow our blogs and follow us on Tech Community. Follow the link that's on the screen. This will allow you to keep up to date to what's going on, engage with the team, and make sure that you're connected with everything that's going on in the world of security.
Awesome. Of course, we'll keep tracking all this on Microsoft Mechanics. Of course, you should follow us on Twitter and hit the subscribe button on YouTube. Thank you all for watching, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you.